difference a year makes, 3 rate hikes, a full percentage point in total in a span of 4 months. We're talking May, June, and August. What event risks are you looking at more closely now? Is it global macro, that includes monetary policy to trade wars, or is it local inflation?
Well, all of the above, Kathy. as you know,
all in priority.
Well, I have the immediate challenge at hand is the domestic one. So right now we're facing elevated risks on inflation. Of course, the origins of that has something to do with supply side factors. But nonetheless, it has created a dynamic of its own. And the BSP certainly needs to deal with that to reassure the public that well, we may not be able to hit our inflation target this year, but we certainly would hit it next year. And that's the reason why we implemented those rate hikes. And we continue to closely monitor the situation so that we'll be able to act in an expeditious manner. What has complicated the picture really is that there's these outside factors that are impinging on policy decisions, primarily to the exchange rate channel. So things like what's happening in Turkey, the trade wars, etc. This creates an element of uncertainty. And together with the normalization in advanced economies, like particularly the US, so this is putting additional pressure. So we have to deal with that as well.
Well, Turkey's turmoil drew comparisons with the Philippines. Some say it's a classic example of what happens when one lets inflation spiral out of control. What can we learn from the Turkey experience?
Well, I think the most important thing is we need to be aware and accept that a lot of investors out there tend to look, unfortunately, at emerging markets as one lump, one basket. And yet, there are very significant differences in these emerging market economies. Different fundamentals, different ways of managing the economy, different approach to making the economies resilient, different political dynamics. So these are the things that we need to emphasize, that while Philippines is an emerging market like Turkey, Philippines is very different in terms of the fundamentals. I wouldn't even say that inflation is spiraling out of control. Yes, it has spiked because of largely supply-side factors. But our expectation is that it will come back to target soon enough. And we have many buffers that create the resilience of the economy. And as recent events have shown, we have demonstrated the ability to respond to changing circumstances by moving policy rates as necessary.
Now, you've been quoted saying August or September inflation number may be higher than July's 5.7%. But at the same time, you've also said inflation separately won't go higher than 6 or 7%. So what exactly is the inflation target range?
Well, for the target range for 2018 hasn't changed. It is 2 to 4%. But if you're asking what is the likely outcome for 2018, it's going to be above 4%. Based on our, we have a projection of inflation path moving forward. And where I was coming from when I mentioned those is, that's at that point of time, our projection that most likely inflation will peak August or September, then starts coming down.
How much higher then, if not 5.7%?
You know, it's very hard to be precise on this number. These are forecasts, and they can be wrong. As you know, just before PSA actually makes the announcement, many private economists put out their numbers. The Department of Finance puts out its number. We also put out our number, which is a range, which basically represents that there are risk factors to putting a number. But certainly my expectation and my hope that it won't reach 6% is still there. And that's something that we want to monitor closely, and we will react depending on what the outcome is.
So what's the bigger driver on inflation? Is it global crude or train tax package one?
Global crude, without doubt, is the key driver of the inflation numbers that we are seeing today. This was precisely the situation that we saw back in 2008, when inflation likewise spiked to around 8% range.
But WTI and Brent have already fallen over the past couple of weeks, so wouldn't that make trains tax package one the bigger driver of inflation?
No, I think with oil prices starting to come down, this will help the forecast that we put forward, that we do anticipate inflation to come down moving forward. And the impact of train, we've always said in the earlier analysis, yes, it will have an impact. It will tend to be moderate, and it will be relatively short term. So it will dissipate as well. Because of the nature, because, you know, inflation is a rate of change. And given that the excise taxes have already been imposed, so it's going to dissipate over time.
Was the cost of raising rates low enough compared with the loss of credibility of the BSP to the markets?
I don't know about loss of credibility. As you know, the BSP decides on these things on the basis of a very careful assessment of the data. We spend an enormous amount of time looking at various facets of the information that is available to the BSP. I would say that the BSP actually would probably have much better information than many other analysts out there. It may be a burden that you have all of this, that you have to weigh this carefully and determine which one is the most important set of numbers at any given point of time. But it imposes a discipline on the process, and we adhere to that careful discipline of being guided by the numbers, not by sentiment, not by public clamor or emotion. We have to calculatedly look at those numbers.
Because foreign fund managers would want to see more rate hikes, would the Banco Central ever consider market response versus data dependency?
Well, you have to balance these things. So market analysts have their own perspective. They also have their own objectives. And they have different risk appetites and horizons. The BSP is here. We're managing this for the Filipino people, for our economy. And we're here to stay. It's not an in and out thing. So we have to carefully look at managing inflation against the risks on economic growth, etc. Because as you know, our mandate calls for price stability conducive to economic growth. So we have a different mandate, and we have to be faithful to that mandate.
So it's no longer just data dependency, but a balance of data dependency and market response, because you've always said that we would like to be data dependent in our next monetary policy decision.
You know, market developments, market views is information to us. So that's an input to the decision set or the information set that we consider in coming up with a decision. Because as you know, one of the drivers of inflation is expectations. And expectations is really a psychological concept rather than a numerical information.